In this video, we're going to look at some basic calculations using specific heat capacities. I have here listed three specific heat capacities I have pulled out of a textbook. Again, I mentioned in the last video, if you're looking these up on the internet, you might find tables with slightly different values depending on which table you're using. These are measured values. You also want to be very careful to watch your units. But I'm going to use these three values in a series of problems. Let's say, for example, I want to know how much heat is it going to take to raise the temperature of a certain sample of copper by a certain amount. All right, I want to know how much heat is required to raise the temperature of 10 grams of copper from 25.5 degrees C to 85.0 degrees C. I am going to have to put heat into my sample of copper. I might stick it on a Bunsen burner. I might put it in a hot water bath. However I'm going to do it, I want to know how much heat, how much energy, I could use the word energy here, and it would mean exactly the same thing, is required to raise the temperature of the sample of copper. And my formula is that the heat is equal to the mass times the specific heat capacity times the change in temperature. And so I would simply plug in my values. The mass is 10 grams. The specific heat capacity I looked up in my table is 0.387. And the change in temperature, remember that your delta T is your final minus your initial. A change is always considered the final minus the initial. This would be 85 minus 25.5, or 59.5 degrees Celsius. This is a positive temperature change. It's going to a higher temperature, and so I will calculate a numerical value for Q that is positive, indicating that that amount of heat should be absorbed. And my answer is, to three significant figures, 230 joules of energy, or joules of heat. And so this would be how I could use this formula to calculate a certain amount of heat given a mass, a specific heat capacity, and a change in temperature. There are other ways to ask this question. For example, all right, what mass of gold could be warmed from 50 degrees Celsius to 110 degrees Celsius using 948 joules of heat? This is somewhat of a make-believe question. I'm not sure we would ever have this specific problem in real life, but it does allow us to see the way that the equation is used and to get some practice calculating the various variables in this equation. Q equals ms delta T. Again, I know that I'm using this formula because I have heat involved and I have a temperature change involved. There is an amount of heat that's either being absorbed or released by a particular substance. The temperature is changing. This is how I calculate it. Now, in this case, I am given 948 joules of heat. I could have said 948 joules of energy. This is my value for Q. I'm trying to find the mass. That's my unknown. I do know the temperature change. I can calculate the delta T. Again, it's final minus initial, or 60 degrees Celsius. And I will be solving for mass. So mass is equal to Q over the specific heat times the change in temperature. And so this is going to be 948 joules. Looks like I need three sig figs again, so how about 122 grams? Again, it's a little bit of a make-believe problem, but it does give us practice using the variables. All right, let's look at another type of problem. All right, if I have both copper and gold, these numerical values give me some information about how those two about what happens to those two as their temperature changes. For example, let's say I have a piece of copper. This is more copper colored. It's not quite that, but you get it. If I have 1 gram of copper, all right, and let's say my copper's pretty hot. Let's say it starts at 100 degrees Celsius. What this specific heat capacity tells me is that if that 1 gram were to fall to 99 degrees Celsius, that would require a release of 0.387 joules of energy. For every 1 gram, a fall of 1 degree releases 0.387 joules. To fall a second degree, to go down to 98 degrees Celsius, requires another release of 0.387 joules. If I have more than 1 gram, I would simply multiply by that amount. Again, it's sort of a scaled factor. It's proportional. The amount of heat is proportional to the mass, and it's proportional to the change in temperature. If I have a sample of gold, all right, my bright, shiny gold, at 100 degrees Celsius, and I've got 1 gram, I'll go to another color that's easier to see. If it falls, in order for it to fall to 99 degrees Celsius, it will only release 0.129 joules of energy for every 1 gram for every 1 degree Celsius. And so copper is releasing more heat for every degree that it falls than gold is. And we can make comparative studies, we can analyze comparatively the amount of heat either required to raise temperatures or that is released based on this specific heat capacity. This gives us a lot of useful information about the substance. Remember that the first law of thermodynamics says that the energy of the universe is constant. The energy of the universe is conserved. One experiment that we can do to try to figure out specific heat capacities is to use a calorimeter. A calorimeter is a device to measure heat changes. A constant pressure calorimeter is what we will use in the laboratory to measure enthalpy changes because it's very easy. Remember that constant volume is needed to measure energy changes. That's a little more difficult experimentally. It takes a much more expensive piece of equipment. A constant pressure calorimeter is a very cheap piece of equipment. In fact, it is simply a couple of coffee cups nested inside of each other. These will thermally insulate the material inside from the surroundings, and so everything that happens in the calorimeter, in the coffee cups, is our system. What we would typically do is we would put some water in our coffee cup calorimeter. Water has a specific heat capacity of 4.184 joules per gram degree Celsius. If we know the mass of the water and the starting temperature of the water, let's say we put a thermometer down in my sample of water so I can monitor the temperature. And then let me take one of these hot pieces of metal. For example, let me take this hot sample of copper and I dunk it down in the water. As the copper's temperature falls, it will release heat. If I have 1 gram and it falls down, as it falls down to 99 degrees Celsius, it will release the 0.387 joules of heat. And in this isolated, because it's a coffee cup, system, it is the water that will absorb the heat. If the water absorbs 0.387 joules of heat, that's not quite enough for it to go up 1 degree for every 1 gram, because it needs 4.184 joules to go up 1 degree for every 1 gram, but I can keep track of how much energy is released by the copper and therefore how much energy is absorbed by the water. And what we end up with is that all of the heat that the copper releases is equal numerically to the heat that the water absorbs. First law of thermodynamics, energy is constant. The energy of the universe is constant, which means any heat released by the copper is going to be absorbed by the water. But recall, we have a sine convention. The copper is releasing the heat, the water is absorbing the heat, and so these two have different numerical signs. It doesn't matter if we make the Q of copper negative or the Q of water negative, it means exactly the same thing. Numerically, they are equivalent in terms of their absolute value, but their sign is different. Well, the Q of copper is equal to ms delta T. The Q of water is equal to ms delta T, where I have different masses, different specific heats, and different temperatures. Now, for the temperatures, I would need temperature changes. And so I would take for copper, if I was looking at copper's temperature change, I would take its initial temperature of 100, and then as I put it in the water, its temperature would fall as water's temperature would rise until they came to the same temperature, and then the temperature would stop moving. So I would record a final temperature on my thermometer. That's actually the final temperature of the water, but that's also the final temperature of my piece of metal, because these two are going to come to the same temperature. That's the zeroth law of thermodynamics. Heat will flow from hot to cold until they become the same temperature, until they're in thermal equilibrium. For my water, I would need my mass of my water, the specific heat capacity of my water. For the delta T of water, I would have some initial in the cup and some final that was on the thermometer. And I could solve for, now I have six variables, MS delta T for copper, MS delta T for water. I could solve for whichever one was missing. This is a typical calorimeter problem where you're using the basic formula Q equals MS delta T, but we're using the first law of thermodynamics to figure out one that's missing.